arguable, so we're all looking at different areas to improve treatment for pancreatic cancer. The area that I'm obviously interested in is radiation therapy. So just to kind of give some background, and I know Sandra will allude to this in a little bit more detail later, will be that pancreatic cancer is ranked as one of the most 10 common cancers diagnosed. It's massively invasive, and in Ireland there's approximately 500 new cases per year. One of the reasons why pancreatic cancer is so deadly is in part due to the late diagnosis of it. Patients are typically at stage 3 or stage 4 when they're diagnosed. There is also quite a limited amount of effective therapies available for doctors to use for the treatment of it. As Dennis already talked about, surgery, radiotherapy and chemotherapy are used quite routinely for cancer treatment. With radiotherapy, particularly in pancreatic cancer, it still remains standard within the treatment. However, the outcomes from a huge number of studies over the last number of years, they haven't been great. They've been very disappointing. In particular, looking at what's called conventional radiotherapy. So conventional radiotherapy is where you give very small doses of radiation therapy to a patient over a prolonged period of time. They could be undergoing radiation treatment for up to 5 or 6 weeks. Most of the radiation that patients in Ireland will receive are with St. Luke's Radiation Oncology Network, which we're very fortunate to have a very strong collaboration with and who fund my work at the moment. So the St. Luke's Radiation Oncology Network is made up of the St. Luke's Hospital in Machgar, and they also have units in Beaumont Hospital and St. James's. As I said, they do provide radiation therapy for cancer patients across Ireland, and we've had a collaboration with them since 2013. Part of our work going on with them, just to kind of give an indication as to how we hope to increase our research outputs, is that we're in the process of actually refurbishing a research lab that we hope will be key for improving our in vitro. So we talk about in vitro, looking at cells as opposed to with patient material. So this is what the lab currently looks like. As I said, it is undergoing refurbishment, and we're hoping to be in by quarter two of next year. And why this is important for sort of the radiation work that I will be talking about in the next slide is that it increases the scope. One of the things with radiation therapy and any of the experiments that you're doing with it is time, so you need to be able to sort of do your work quite quickly after you've treated yourself, because that's when you're going to see the most interesting or some of the most interesting results. And unfortunately at the moment we're approximately about a 40 minute drive from St. Luke's. So by having the advanced lab over in St. Luke's, we are going to be able to increase the amount of scope that we'll be able to look at. In addition to that, and what's very important, and I know Alex will touch on in translational research and some of the work that Sandra will talk about, is we'll have clinicians that will be more readily available to us as they'll be on site. So we'll be able to make sure that the work that we're doing is clinically relevant. There's no point in us treating cells at doses that will never be given to a patient. And it will provide a unique satellite research facility that we hope will be open to more research labs that will work with St. Luke's in relation to radiation biology. So from my perspective, in the areas of radiation biology that the NICB are hoping to focus on is looking at the tumour microenvironment. So pancreatic cancer, one of the reasons that it doesn't respond exceptionally well to treatment is the way that the tumour is made. Dennis had alluded that there's different cell types and there's blood vessels. Within a pancreatic tumour, there's also what are called stromal cells. These stromal cells form quite dense barriers around the cancer cells, and as a result, provide protection to those cells against the likes of chemotherapy or radiation therapy. And we want to see, is there ways for us to break that down, make it more, make it easier to treat the pancreatic cancer. One of the main areas of interest for the NICB has always been resistance to therapy. It happens routinely nowadays, particularly with some of the small molecules that Dennis had talked about. So resistance and understanding it and the mechanisms behind it are obviously key importance, because if a patient becomes resistant to a therapy, that therapy is no longer going to be of use to them. And given that there's already limited therapeutic options for pancreatic cancer, we want to ensure that what is available is being used to its best. And finally, looking at therapies. So as I mentioned, most radiation therapy is given by conventional methods in that it's given in low doses over a prolonged period of times, which as a result can open it up to resistance. The cells can train themselves to become resistant to the therapy. So one of the new areas that we're looking at is what's called hyperfractionation therapy. It's where the cells will be treated with much higher doses over longer periods of time. The main issue with this is that while we know it has worked, there has been clinical trials in the States, we don't understand fully the biology and the mechanisms behind how it works. So we're hoping to do some investigations into that and see is there ways for us to combine it with the likes of chemotherapy or the small molecules that Dennis discussed, or is there ways for us to sensitise the tumours that these higher fractions will be of better use. So that just kind of is a very overall kind of snapshot of what the radiation biology work that's going on in the NICB, which we hope to grow in the next 2 years between here and St. Luke's. So obviously very important, none of this work is capable without funding. As I said, St. Luke's have been very generous with us. So thank you.